right. I am happy to be joined with Bruce Linton. He is a strategic advisor with Creso Pharma. Bruce, great to have you back on. How are things?
Oh, things are good, Chad. Happy Monday, man.
Yeah, you as well. Wanted to have you on. Want to get right into it. Let's talk about this merger announcement last week with Creso Pharma and Red Light Holland, two companies that you're obviously very well connected with. Creso Pharma has a psychedelics pharmaceutical division named Hallucinix. It is primarily known for its CBD assets and animal care products, where it derives most of its revenue. And Red Light Holland is known primarily for its retail psychedelic truffles business in Netherlands and distribution business. So walk me through, what does this partnership mean and what can shareholders of Creso anticipate moving forward?
Yeah, so no, being on the ASX is interesting, right? In order to get the right to pursue Hallucinix, that was months and months and months of work by the crew.
Okay.
But if you said, well, now we'd like to actually go a little further, maybe we'd like to access US, because if you're comfortable with CBD for animals, now you're comfortable with psychedelics and research in that space and science, would you be uncomfortable as an investor seeing your stock go up because you now found a good asset in US THC? I don't think so, but the exchange is.
So what does that mean?
It means they can't do it. So like if Creso stayed on their own on the ASX, they can't enter the US THC market.
Mm-hmm.
Which means there's an opportunity that they can't exploit because of who regulates what they do as a trading entity.
Right.
So when you put the two together, you have brand, think Red Light Holland, you have a nod to science and a great push towards responsible enjoyment, access to truly package what we said it will be. And so now all of a sudden the optionality for the companies together is listed on CSE means you can go play with US THC assets.
Yep.
Have global opportunities related to, we'll call it truffles, psilocybin, writ large, and science coming out of Switzerland. So now what we look at is we have this playing field where the science tells us how to make better care for animals and for humans, principally CBD, but you can use the same delivery mechanisms to start plugging in THC. And so now when you look at that playing field, you say, well, as an investor in the resulting entity, I like this deal. I wonder what they're going to do next should be the first thing that crosses their mind.
It's interesting.
And so I love it because I'm going to be able to, if this closes and we close a few things up, September, say, I can come in and be more directly involved as chair of the board. What right. I do with these companies is each week I spoke to them about what they're working on internationally, and particularly with Creso, I focused outside of Canada. I focused on like, where do these animal care products plug in? We had another one, we talked to them, almost pulled the trigger on putting the entities together, but there wasn't quite enough in it for Creso.
Right.
And so this is just a better fit.
Do you think that there's momentum building as far as the overall awareness of Creso and the story that they're starting to, structure and manufacture?
I think as a stock there is, and I think as a company, we're going to start to consolidate and use Creso equals science, Red Light equals the result of the science getting consumed by a human. There's a place for both of them to have a storyboard, and it brings the sophistication of science with the enjoyment. Like, remember, Red Light, what is the Red Light District? The Red Light District is an area that means they're trying to give people safety, but not necessarily legality, but not illegal access to what was in the day, you know, the sex trade. And so it was really governed in a way to make it that kind of middle zone between illegal and legal to be safe. That's what we're about. That's where we play. So what Creso shareholders are getting access to is an ever more aggressive market opportunity. We can do everything they did before, but we can do more now because of that exchange item. So as a shareholder, and I have a nice chunk in Creso, I haven't sold one.
It's great.
And what I like about where is it going is, you know, we might have to work on the cap table, because I think when you put the two together, it's approaching that billion shares outstanding, which you and I know, 300 to 400 million, that's a good number, because if you're going to go buy somebody after we put this together, they're going to want equity. We're going to use equity. So you can't get too big a number. Otherwise, it's like to infinity and beyond almost when you're trying to figure out how many shares. So I just think there's some mechanics to do that will tighten this up. Cash should be around 35 to 50 million, you know, give or take. It actually should be north of 40. So it's going to be well cashed up.
Okay.
Good story. Strong team.
Yeah.
Like, I'm liking who they're adding. They need to have, you know, beef it up a little bit more, and maybe the technology, the CIO, how do we make all these reporting entities tie together? But I think it's a machine ready for options. Options mean make more deals. More deals mean put pieces together, keep moving. What are shareholders like? Action.
Of course, especially in this day and age. When I look at this merger and this announcement, the name, strong, HighBrid Labs. So what's the mission statement when I think about that name?
Well, so it was kind of a fun game. I will take credit for HighBrid.
Okay.
And it's
love because, the humility, Bruce.
Well, it's because I say, guys, I like HighBrid could mean like we're this best of both breeds, but the way we spell it and the way we position it, it also means we want you to have a little fun high.
Right.
And so like it's intended to give you this this opportunity to be comfortable with the science, the adults running it, but then the brands, so you're going to own stock in HighBrid, but you're going to buy products sometimes called Red Light.
Right.
And so it's a spot where science, fun, and that gray zone of business all come together.
Yeah. What synergies do you see between both companies that will make the entities stronger together than, say, they would otherwise apart?
I think both of them have struggled in terms of they're getting all of their supply chains organized, but they have the same double costs and reporting being an audited entity. That's a big cost and it goes together easier. But at the end of the day, that leaves you less and less time for revenue generation channels. How do I take my intellectual property to the ends of the earth where it should be?
Right.
And so I think we're going to be able to see the ability to bring more focus on revenue generation than either could on their own.
Yeah.
I know it's out of fashion to generate rapidly growing sales. Everybody should just put out press releases. But I actually like the idea that we should be able to be, when I liked Red Light and when I liked Creso, what I said is these are the two entities I see as near-term revenue generators that can create brands that could have a long story.
Yeah.
I have other ones which will not see revenue for years because it's like clinical trial kind of things. Think, you know, MindMed. And so I want to have both. And this should be in people's portfolio as they're going to grow revenues. They have options to expand into all corners of this game. And they should be really opportunistic and jump at them. And I think we will be.
That's the interesting part about the psychedelic space is people, investors want to see things move fast. They love hot new industries. However, clinical trials only go at a certain pace, right?
Right.
So
and like the markets are small. Like if you said how many people have legal access in Canada, it's a handful. Mm-hmm. And it took some time for cannabis to go that way. So I think what you want to have is you want to have something going there, but that shouldn't be the only thing you have going because people might fall asleep watching your stock. And I think, you know, when HighBrid comes together, there'd be the meld of the two. Mm-hmm. It should have enough things going on. There's something moving kind of in a good way every day.
So when we talk about pace, interesting point to say the least, with this merger, will it allow Creso to scale the Hallucinix business operations more quickly?
It should, you know, there's still subjectivity to that, right? They have to get these licenses all through so that I think everybody knows is still a work in progress, but with a lot of these regulators, it's stick with it and you get it done. But it should allow to keep enhancing the science.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that science, you said, well, what do you get so excited about science? Well, there's an awful lot of products for animal, and we've talked about this, animal care, but they're not based on science. So you don't really, what's the dosage per kilogram of dog, for example? Mm-hmm. What's the expected outcome? So they've done a good job on that. Well, when we start thinking about psilocybin and having access to actual people who are on that registered patient list, we can start getting at that, I think, through these guys and start to be able to say, you know, it's a small sample, but we tested this in Canada, which helps you win an argument and say, Italy, mm-hmm. this is why you should change your policy. We have this data. So, you know, you're on the inside using your own advantages when you actually have the clinical piece as well.
And do you see that happening, for example?
Well, I think mental health writ large is going to be the number one conversation that happens after COVID's over.
For sure.
So how the hell did you get through and how are you feeling about life and how do you want to live the best rest of your life is going to be an ongoing dialogue.
For sure.
And so I think the conversations around what works versus what rampant prohibitionist nonsense we inherited before COVID. So I think policymakers are going to be on their toes to look. The other part is, as far as I can tell, COVID has been god awful for the national books of every country, except for maybe China. And so I think they're going to be very open to, oh, we could have a lab, maybe we could get intellectual property. If we change this, it could actually squeeze out costs on pharmaceuticals. So I just think there's a next couple of years of very interesting conversations with big policy folks who might be more receptive than we would have thought 18 months ago.
Yeah. We're starting to hear more and more about you, like, you know, really get into this as far as the industry starting to expand, the company's obviously advancing. So with your involvement with Creso as a strategic advisor and position as a non-exclusive chairperson at Red Light Holland, you have a pre-existing involvement with both companies. As such, do you expect to be more hands-on involvement with HighBrid Labs?
Oh yeah. So this is a part of the negotiation. We haven't finished all, but like subject two, when this thing's done, I would expect to chair the first meeting in September, October.
Okay.
So I'll have to get a few things sorted, but nothing material. To me, that allows me to actually, there's enough here that I want to work with these guys. I love working with Todd. Will Lay, who's come on as sort of the strategic acquisition guy, he worked with me at Canopy. He was my right-hand man when we did the Acreage deal.
Yep.
And, you know, that was a pretty creative deal. I think we're starting to put together kind of an A-list of folks who want to really make a change. So we'll see where we end up with, like, the finance function. I bet we end up, right now, you know, we all these places use part-time folks.
Right.
You put this together, and now you can actually carry a super skilled full-timer.
Mm-hmm.
And what that does is it changes how you look at deals, because you're running all these pro formas and you're seeing it. How will this look the day, week, year after we do the deal? What do we have to play with on instruments that we have? So I think we're going to end up with a silly team of really capable people, and we might actually have a chance to go and build something that we can't all picture yet today. But when you make 3, 4, 5, 6 moves, things start to come together and you go, wow, we got leverage here.
No idea is ever too out of the box, it seems like, in 2021, as we endure all these new things, doesn't it?
It's, well, you know what? I just I'm really liking, like, Canada, we're kind of stuck still feeling COVID-ish, but the rest of the world's getting pretty aggressive.
For sure they are.
And so, like, I like that aggressive feeling. And so I think this is, it's going to fit well in the new post-COVID aggressive world. Like, let's get out and do some deals.
2 months ago, there was a sold out game in Texas for baseball, and we thought, that's crazy. Now it's like seeing no fans, like we're watching hockey games and there's no fans in arenas. We think that's crazy now, for sure.
Yeah.
Last thing I want to, like, leave with you on this is that if there's one takeaway to both Creso and Red Light Holland investors who are trying to make sense of this merger, what is the key message you would relate on why this makes sense? And why you expect shareholder value will be created for investors of both companies that you haven't already mentioned.
Sure. So it lands on the right exchange to move against any option. We're open to any action that fits in that bailiwick I described, which could be US THC right through other psychoactive ingredients. It consolidates the cost base of being a listed entity, allows us to upgrade and bring more skilled talent to play, and it has a strong cash position. Mm-hmm. But when you put those together, the next thing you know, you're actually moving forward with more speed than they could have individually, with a bigger breadth of opportunity than they could have individually. And there's no certainty this turns into the best thing ever, but it's definitely an improved opportunity when you have those attributes. So I really like it. And everybody can say, well, you know, I just like when I stay still. Well, you know what? That doesn't work for very long. Staying in your own lane, doing your own thing. I just think these are, and there's 100 more targets out there that could be tuck-ins. Like, I think this is a big move followed by a bunch of smaller moves.
You're either growing or you're dying, right?
If you're not first, you're last.
That's right. Bruce is back. Appreciate the update, right?
Good stuff. Thanks, man.
All right. Thanks, Bruce. Bye-bye.